Now we have Professor Glen Cooper, who will finally present his paper on Astrolabes and Zijes. Am I pronouncing it correctly?
Yeah, Zijes or
Zijes or Zijes, as tools of education and the transmission of scientific knowledge from Islamic civilization. Please go ahead.
A while back, as part of a project to trace astrological concepts in medicine through Greek, Arabic, and Latin, I was intrigued by what David King and Charles Burnett have written about the role of the astrolabe in transmitting science to the West. George Saliba had taught me that the Zijes played a large role in the development of Islamic astronomy and its transmission, as well as my own fascination with calculating devices and tables is what enticed me into the history of Islamic science to begin with. Together, these ingenious tools served scientific education and research in the Muslim world and its intellectual heir, the West, as they had done in the Greek, Persian, and Indian worlds before them. Although today we know much more about Islamic Zijes and astronomical instruments through the research of David King and his students, as he has pointed out, there is a mass of material still to be explored, a situation that mirrors the state of the study of Arabic scientific manuscripts generally, as we've heard. While we can trace the history of astrolabes in terms of treatises on how to construct and use them, and how to use Zijes to generate almanacs and ephemerides, there seems to be little or no evidence from actual classroom contexts about how students actually learn these skills, or at least that's as unknown to me. So in order to get greater insight into the educational context, this semester I have integrated them into my History of Islamic Science course. Students assemble and learn to use astrolabes and to perform general astronomical calculations, as well as specifically Islamic ones. And they learn the theory behind planetary tables and use them to calculate their own natal charts. Here, I shall sketch these devices and their histories. Then I shall describe how these devices can be taught in a modern educational context. The historical part of this is based on the works of Edward Kennedy and David King. The modern part is original with me. Now, the astrolabe is a most ingenious device that is as useful as it is beautiful. Muslim civilization first encountered the astrolabe in Haran, probably where there were astrolabe workshops. Muhammad ibn Ibrahim al-Fazari, 8th century, reportedly was the first Muslim to construct one. But the oldest extant Islamic astrolabes date from late 8th century Baghdad, and is a copy of a Byzantine exemplar. The earliest surviving Arabic treatise on the construction and use of the astrolabe is one by Al-Khwarizmi, 9th century, but the culmination of that tradition was Al-Biruni's great 11th century treatise. The astrolabe is a portable model of the cosmos that can represent the positions of the sun and major stars at any time of the day or year for a given latitude. The rotating reet represents the heavens, and the plate, with its fixed celestial coordinate grid, represents the stationary Earth. The observer orients himself with respect to the horizon, meridian, zenith, and pole star. Interchangeable plates for other latitudes could be carried inside the body of the astrolabe. The most useful aspect of the astrolabe is that, because of the way the celestial sphere is projected onto the plate, it can solve graphically many problems that would otherwise require spherical trigonometry. The astrolabe on the right once belonged to the 15th century Timurid ruler Ulugh Beg of Samarkand, who was also an astronomer and a mathematician. On the left are examples from the Museum of History of Science, Oxford, which has so many astrolabes, both Islamic and European, that you almost trip over them. As stated earlier, the astrolabe was an important vector of the transmission of scientific knowledge to Europe. Here is the earliest extant astrolabe in medieval Europe, the so-called Carolingian astrolabe. For some Europeans, such as Peter Abelard in the 12th century, the astrolabe even symbolized the superiority of Arabic scientific culture. Although the astrolabe was originally a Greek invention, the Arabic tradition developed it to new heights of sophistication, just as it did with nearly everything else from Greek. For example, on the left is the universal astrolabe plate invented by the 11th century Andalusian Ibn al-Zakalu, which can be used for all latitudes. On the right is the 1328-29 masterpiece designed by Ibn al-Siraj in Aleppo. Said to have been the most sophisticated astrolabe ever made, it can be used universally in 5 different ways. We've seen this already today. Astrolabes were only the beginning of ingenious instrument design in Islam. They are best known to the West, in the West, because they were one of the intriguing devices brought back to Europe from the Muslim world in the 10th and 11th centuries, which spurred the Latins on to study math and astronomy. There were a host of other instruments for various purposes, most of which are known now only by their descriptions. An important exception, of course, is the universal Qibla computer, which David King has already talked about today, whose projection of geography enables the nomographical determination of the sacred direction for many cities. Now, zijes were the earliest kind of astronomical text to be composed in Arabic. Called zij because their characteristic form resembles a loom, there were zij traditions in Sanskrit and Pahlavi, which, along with Ptolemy's handy tables, influenced the Islamic tradition. Zijes consisted of numerous kinds of tables and algorithms for the computation of planetary positions, prayer times, and much more. They conveyed a great deal of astronomical knowledge via the models that generated the tables and the numerical parameters on which they were based. Professor Kennedy's chart shows the legacies of zijes between several cultures. The earliest known zij was that was of interest to Muslim astronomers was the Zij al-Arkand, an Arabic version of a Sanskrit original with Pahlavi sources composed in Sindh, India in 735 CE. The most important Indian zij to be studied in Islam was the Mahasiddhanta, translated by Al-Fazari as Zij as-Sindhind al-Kabir. Al-Khwarizmi's Zij as-Sindhind, not the same as Al-Fazari's translation, is the earliest non-fragmentary Zij to survive from the Arabic tradition, although it is extant only in Latin. The correction and improvement of Zijs were justifications for the imperial sponsorship of observational astronomy. The first major such effort was Al-Ma'mun's sponsored astronomical observations of 828-29, which resulted in the new Zij, corrected via new observations, the Zij al-Mumtahan, the verified Zij, one of which we've just heard about, by Yahya ibn Abi Mansur, died 832. Okay, now when teaching the history of Islamic astronomy, as I'm doing in my class this semester, showing diagrams of astrolabes and planetary models is far too abstract for most students. Learning to use the tables helps them to better appreciate why the models were devised and refined. Moreover, assembling an astrolabe and learning how to calculate with it gives students deeper insight than any amount of reading can do. Although instruction manuals survive, we know very little about how these tools were actually taught. Therefore, I decided to do this experiment in my History of Islamic Science course in order to seek insights from a modern classroom experiment. In this class, I'm testing how a group of modern students, mostly innocent of astronomy, would learn to use these devices effectively. How much background knowledge would I need to provide them, and how much would they be able to learn, not only about the ancient cosmos, but also about Islamic astronomy and its role in Islamic society in particular. There are special challenges for 21st century students. For how many stars can you actually see in London or Los Angeles in the evening? And can it be taught within a semester? In effect, I'm requiring that these students practice seeing the cosmos from the point of view of the 9th century Muslims as much as possible. By this experiment, I hope to shed light on the thesis that the astrolabe was an important vector of mathematical and astronomical knowledge to Europe, and that it was pregnant with learning implications. Now, this is the model that I actually use. It can be made of cardboard, wood, paper, and it has all the essential elements: the plate, the reet, which represents the rotating heavens, the rule on the front, which helps align all of the objects. On the back, we have a number of nomographs that I'll talk about in a moment for doing calculations, plus this alidade here. Now, there's one flaw with this astrolabe, of course. In a real one, the alidade would have a sighting tube on it for testing elevations of buildings or stars. I don't have one on here because it was too fragile, but in any case, maybe eventually when I teach them how to build them out of brass, we'll do that. Okay. Now, while I eventually plan to generate my own plates and faces for astrolabes using my own computer programs and to make them more Islamic in style, for now I use this website, which generates EPS files for the plates for your precise latitude and provides a time correction for the longitude. So this screenshot shows that the program allows you to customize your astrolabe by choosing between various features. The possible variations become very numerous on the backside, since many options are provided, drawn from historical examples. Why use English and not Arabic? Well, most of the students don't know Arabic. And anyway, all of these features are standard to many Islamic astrolabes. So here are the front plates for London and Claremont, California, where I live, and you can see how the difference in latitude affects the arcs. Let's see. Sorry. So this is the horizon line down at the bottom of the grid. That's a major orientation line as well as the meridian going up and down. And these grids above the horizon line are a coordinate system for locating objects in the sky. Here they're gridated in units of 5 degrees. Now the back has a nomograph for converting between the civil calendar and the solar longitude in zodiac coordinates by aligning the alidade. Another useful feature are the cotangent scales on the bottom half, which are used to convert a gnomon's shadow length into an angle to determine the sun's altitude. The arcs and lines on the front plate can all be drawn using a straight edge and compass. This is an assignment, however, for a higher level course. George Saliba actually had me do this in grad school, which was one of the most important assignments I ever did, as it turns out. At least until I got married and my wife gave me a list of things to do. But the reet contains the moving parts of the astrolabe, and by rotating it, one can mirror the state of the heavens at any time of day or night for any day of the year for a specific latitude. Problems that would require spherical trigonometry are solved visually. So the first thing I do is to have the students locate the sun on the ecliptic circle of the reet for a given solar longitude. I ask them to imagine a little orange dot at that point in order to keep the sun in mind as they rotate the reet in their calculations. After finding the horizon, I show them how to trace the sun's arc throughout the day from sunrise to sunset, noting how that arc is larger or smaller depending on the season. The astrolabe is a kind of 24-hour clock. Then I ask them how they would find the time of sunrise. The answer, of course, is to align the sun and the rule at the eastern horizon and read the time of sunrise from the outer scale. Students grasp this fairly easily. I next ask them how far north or south of due east will the sun rise. They use the azimuth lines to determine the degree difference between the sun's rising point and due east. So here's due east, due west. The sun can rise at any point along these azimuth degrees there. Now the times that they find are local apparent solar time, which is different from clock time. So I show them how to use the equation of time and the time zone correction to get clock time. Now this information was found in tables in a Zij. I have not yet adapted one from a real Zij yet. After they have practiced with rising and setting times, finding the ascendant, and telling time from the sun's or star's altitude, they are ready to calculate Islamic prayer times. Since this is a History of Islamic Science course, they already know what these are and why they are important. I have them fill out this chart for a given day. Four of the prayer times are straightforward and can be determined using the front of the astrolabe by positioning the sun in the appropriate position. The Salat al-Asr, however, is more complicated since it is defined, according to one way, as the time when the sun's shadow equals the length of the gnomon plus the shadow length at noon. So here comes the cotangent nomograph. The cotangent nomograph is used to convert gnomon ratios to angles and vice versa. So, to determine the starting time of Salat al-Asr, I have them fill out this chart, which is an algorithm that employs the cotangent scale. This prayer time requires them to do two iterations of cotangents and arccotangents on the back of their astrolabes. Now, my algorithm enables students to do with greater precision what this nomograph on the back of an astrolabe was meant to do. Using an astrolabe for determining prayer times may not have been common when prayer times were available in prayer tables, but this is a convenient backup. In all, my students learn to perform all of these operations, from time of day, time of night, sunrise, sunset, ascendant, of course, the astrological factors and so on. Now, when I was a graduate student, sorry, Professor Saliba, I'm going to mention you again. George had me construct an astrolabe from scratch and work through all of the mathematics also behind Ptolemy's planetary models. However, because I can't require all that of students in a single semester, history survey course, these books have been helpful shortcuts. I teach them how the basic planetary models were derived and how their parameters were determined from observation. And we talk about the impossibility of the equant point in the model for Mars. I explain that they will first determine the approximate position of the planet by using the mean motion tables and then adjust it more precisely using equation tables, all by addition and subtraction. This is done instead of using trigonometry, which already has been done by the Zijes compiler. So since this assignment is integrated with the History of Islamic Astronomy unit, they learn about the critique and improvement of Ptolemy's models by Muslim astronomers. Then I introduce them to the three Zijes tables that they will use to determine the solar equation. They are the table of mean motions, the table of the solar apogee, and the table of the solar equation, right there. Then this is the algorithm that they follow. This chart covers every step with an explanation. First, they compute the sun's mean position, then they adjust it with the equation from this table. Now, the spreadsheet helps them keep their sexagesimal arithmetic straight. Now, once they've mastered the solar equation, they are ready to tackle the planet Mars, an upper planet, which requires them to determine two mean motions and two equations. So it's a little bit more complicated, as is the algorithm. Lastly, I show them how to find the ascendant using the table of ascensions for the appropriate latitude. Now, the goal of this assignment is for them to fill out this chart for their own nativity, illustrating the activity of astrologers historically. For the moon and other planets, we must use a shortcut since I don't have those algorithms worked out yet in an easy form. So we use a historical ephemeris table. Now, my goal is eventually to produce a modernized Zijes that contains typical elements from that tradition for students to study and practice with. Now, so far, the students are grasping all of this. Some have required individual attention, but once they grasp the underlying principles, most of the rest comes easily. Future educational projects, Equatoria and additional Zijes tables. Abu Ja'far al-Khazin, late 10th century, in his Zijes as-Safa'i, devised plates that combine Zijes-like tables and Equatorium-like plates to enable finding of the planet's true longitudes. The culmination of the equatorium tradition in Islam was Al-Kashi's 15th century planetary longitude computer, as well as other devices of his device. In the future, I plan to teach students how to use equatoria or analog computers for computing planetary longitudes graphically based on Al-Kashi's intriguing 15th century device and also the 16th century cardboard models of Peter Apian. Now, in conclusion, as part of the evaluation of this project, I have asked students to fill out a questionnaire. And since the semester is not quite over, I don't yet know how it all will pan out, but some of the comments that I've received so far are as follows. What a great way to learn about Islamic culture. Or, my dad is an engineer and I can't wait to show him how to use this astrolabe. Another enthusiastic student said, "In all my other classes, we just read and discuss things. This is the first class where we've had a learning activity like this. I'll never forget what I've learned." Another student said, "I had no idea that the Muslims were so smart." And lastly, "It gave me greater appreciation of how advanced Muslim civilization was." So these activities fit well, so far as I've seen this semester, they fit well within the context of a traditional history course, intellectual history course, and I highly recommend them. So thank you.
Now we have Professor Glen Cooper, who will finally present his paper on astrolabes and Zijes. Am I pronouncing it correctly?
Yeah, Zijes or
Zijes or Zijes, as tools of education and the transmission of scientific knowledge from Islamic civilization. Please go ahead.
them to construct one. But the oldest extant Islamic astrolabes date from late 8th century Baghdad, and is a copy of a Byzantine exemplar. The earliest surviving Arabic treatise on the construction and use of the astrolabe is one by Al-Khwarizmi, 9th century, but the culmination of that tradition was Al-Biruni's great 11th century treatise. The astrolabe is a portable model of the cosmos that can represent the positions of the sun and major stars at any time of the day or year for a given latitude. The rotating reet represents the heavens, and the plate, with its fixed celestial coordinate grid, represents the stationary Earth. The observer orients himself with respect to the horizon, meridian, zenith, and pole star. Interchangeable plates for other latitudes could be carried inside the body of the astrolabe. The most useful aspect of the astrolabe is that, because of the way the celestial sphere is projected onto the plate, it can solve graphically many problems that would otherwise require spherical trigonometry. The astrolabe on the right once belonged to the 15th century Timurid ruler Ulugh Beg of Samarkand, who was also an astronomer and a mathematician. On the left are examples from the Museum of History of Science, Oxford, which has so many astrolabes, both Islamic and European, that you almost trip over them. As stated earlier, the astrolabe was an important vector of the transmission of scientific knowledge to Europe. Here is the earliest extant astrolabe in medieval Europe, the so-called Carolingian astrolabe. For some Europeans, such as Peter Abelard in the 12th century, the astrolabe even symbolized the superiority of Arabic scientific culture. Although the astrolabe was originally a Greek invention, the Arabic tradition developed it to new heights of sophistication, just as it did with nearly everything else from Greek. For example, on the left is the universal astrolabe plate invented by the 11th century Andalusian Ibn al-Zakalu, which can be used for all latitudes. On the right is the 1328-29 masterpiece designed by Ibn al-Siraj in Aleppo. Said to have been the most sophisticated astrolabe ever made, it can be used universally in 5 different ways. We've seen this already today. Astrolabes were only the beginning of ingenious instrument design in Islam. They are best known to the West, in the West, because they were one of the intriguing devices brought back to Europe from the Muslim world in the 10th and 11th centuries, which spurred the Latins on to study math and astronomy. There were a host of other instruments for various purposes, most of which are known now only by their descriptions. An important exception, of course, is this universal Qibla computer, which David King has already talked about today, whose projection of geography enables the nomographical determination of the sacred direction for many cities. Now, zijes were the earliest kind of astronomical text to be composed in Arabic. Called zij because their characteristic form resembles a loom, there were zij traditions in Sanskrit and Pahlavi, which, along with Ptolemy's handy tables, influenced the Islamic tradition. Zijes consisted of numerous kinds of tables and algorithms for the computation of planetary positions, prayer times, and much more. They conveyed a great deal of astronomical knowledge via the models that generated the tables and the numerical parameters on which they were based. Professor Kennedy's chart shows the legacies of zijes between several cultures. The earliest known zij was of interest to Muslim astronomers was the zij al-Arkand, an Arabic version of a Sanskrit original with Pahlavi sources composed in Sindh, India in 735 CE. The most important Indian zij to be studied in Islam was the Mahasiddhanta, translated by Al-Fazari as Zij as-Sindhind al-Kabir. Al-Khwarizmi's Zij as-Sindhind, not the same as Al-Fazari's translation, is the earliest non-fragmentary Zij to survive from the Arabic tradition, although it is extant only in Latin. The correction and improvement of Zijes were justifications for the imperial sponsorship of observational astronomy. The first major such effort was Al-Ma'mun's sponsored astronomical observations of 828-29, which resulted in the new Zij, corrected via new observations, the Azij al-Mumtahan, the verified Zij, one of which we've just heard about, by Yahya ibn Abi Mansur, died 832. Okay, now when teaching the history of Islamic astronomy, as I'm doing in my class this semester, showing diagrams of astrolabes and planetary models is far too abstract for most students. Learning to use the tables helps them to better appreciate why the models were devised and refined. Moreover, assembling an astrolabe and learning how to calculate with it gives students deeper insight than any amount of reading can do. Although instruction manuals survive, we know very little about how these tools were actually taught. Therefore, I decided to do this experiment in my History of Islamic Science course in order to seek insights from a modern classroom experiment. In this class, I'm testing how a group of modern students, mostly innocent of astronomy, would learn to use these devices effectively. How much background knowledge would I need to provide them, and how much would they be able to learn, not only about the ancient cosmos, but also about Islamic astronomy and its role in Islamic society in particular. There are special challenges for 21st century students. For how many stars can you actually see in London or Los Angeles in the evening? And can it be taught within a semester? In effect, I'm requiring that these students practice seeing the cosmos from the point of view of the 9th century Muslims as much as possible. By this experiment, I hope to shed light on the thesis that the astrolabe was an important vector of mathematical and astronomical knowledge to Europe, and that it was pregnant with learning implications. Now, this is the model that I actually use. It can be made of cardboard, wood, paper, and it has all the essential elements: the plate, the reet, which represents the rotating heavens, the rule on the front, which helps align all of the objects. On the back, we have a number of nomographs that I'll talk about in a moment for doing calculations, plus this alidade here. Now, there's one flaw with this astrolabe, of course. In a real one, the alidade would have a sighting tube on it for point in order to keep the sun in mind as they rotate the reed in their calculations. After finding the horizon, I show them how to trace the sun's arc throughout the day, from sunrise to sunset, noting how that arc is larger or smaller depending on the season. The astrolabe is a kind of 24-hour clock. Then I ask them how they would find the time of sunrise. The answer, of course, is to align the sun and the rule at the eastern horizon and read the time of sunrise from the outer scale. Students grasp this fairly easily. I next ask them how far north or south of due east will the sun rise. They use the azimuth lines to determine the degree difference between the sun's rising point and due east. So here's due east, due west. The sun can rise at any point along these azimuth degrees there. Now the times that they find are local apparent solar time, which is different from clock time. So I show them how to use the equation of time and the time zone correction to get clock time. Now this information was found in tables in a Zij. I have not yet adapted one from a real Zij yet. After they have practiced with rising and setting times, finding the ascendant, and telling time from the sun's or star's altitude, they are ready to calculate Islamic prayer times. Since this is a history of Islamic science course, they already know what these are and why they are important. I have them fill out this chart for a given day. Four of the prayer times are straightforward and can be determined using the front of the astrolabe by positioning the sun in the appropriate position. The Salat al-Asr, however, is more complicated since it is defined, according to one way, as the time when the sun's shadow equals the length of the gnomon plus the shadow length at noon. So here comes the cotangent nomograph. The cotangent nomograph is used to convert gnomon ratios to angles and vice versa. So, to determine the starting time of Salat al-Asr, I have them fill out this chart, which is an algorithm that employs the cotangent scale. This prayer time requires them to do two iterations of cotangents and arc cotangents on the back of their astrolabes. Now, my algorithm enables students to do with greater precision what this nomograph on the back of an astrolabe was meant to do. Using an astrolabe for determining prayer times may not have been common when prayer times were available in prayer tables, but this is a convenient backup. In all, my students learn to perform all of these operations, from time of day, time of night, sunrise, sunset, ascendant, of course, the astrological factors, and so on. Now, when I was a graduate student, sorry, Professor Saliba, I'm going to mention you again. George had me construct an astrolabe from scratch and work through all of the mathematics, also behind Ptolemy's planetary models. However, because I can't require all that of students in a single semester, history survey course, these books have been helpful shortcuts. I teach them how the basic planetary models were derived and how their parameters were determined from observation. And we talk about the impossibility of the equant point in the model for Mars. I explain that they will first determine the approximate position of the planet by using the mean motion tables, and then adjust it more precisely using equation tables, all by addition and subtraction. This is done instead of using trigonometry, which already has been done by the Zij compiler. So since this assignment is integrated with the History of Islamic Astronomy unit, they learn about the critique and improvement of Ptolemy's models by Muslim astronomers. Then I introduce them to the three Zij tables that they will use to determine the solar equation. They are the table of mean motions, the table of the solar apogee, and the table of the solar equation, right there. Then this is the algorithm that they follow. This chart covers every step with an explanation. First, they compute the sun's mean position, then they adjust it with the equation from this table. Now, the spreadsheet helps them keep their sexagesimal arithmetic straight. Now, once they've mastered the solar equation, they are ready to tackle the planet Mars, an upper planet, which requires them to determine two mean motions and two equations. So it's a little bit more complicated. As is the algorithm. Lastly, I show them how to find the ascendant using the table of ascensions for the appropriate latitude. Now, the goal of this assignment is for them to fill out this chart for their own nativity, illustrating the activity of astrologers historically. For the moon and other planets, we must use a shortcut since I don't have those algorithms worked out yet in an easy form. So we use a historical ephemeris table. Now, my goal is eventually to produce a modernized Zij that contains typical elements from that tradition for students to study and practice with. Now, so far, the students are grasping all of this. Some have required individual attention, but once they grasp the underlying principles, most of the rest comes easily. Future educational projects, Equatoria and additional Zij tables. Abu Ja'far al-Khazin, late 10th century, in his Zij as-Safa'i, devised plates that combine Zij-like tables and equatorium-like plates to enable finding of the planet's true longitudes. The culmination of the equatorium tradition in Islam was al-Kashi's 15th century planetary longitude computer, as well as other devices of his device. In the future, I plan to teach students how to use equatoria or analog computers for computing planetary longitudes graphically based on al-Kashi's intriguing 15th century device and also the 16th century cardboard models of Peter Apian. Now, in conclusion, as part of the evaluation of this project, I have asked students to fill out a questionnaire. And since the semester is not quite over, I don't yet know how it all will pan out, but some of the comments that I've received so far are as follows. What a great way to learn about Islamic culture. Or, my dad is an engineer and I can't wait to show him how to use this astrolabe. Another enthusiastic student said, in all my other classes, we just read and discuss things. This is the first class where we've had a learning activity like this. I'll never forget what I've learned. Another student said, I had no idea that the Muslims were so smart. And lastly, it gave me greater appreciation of how advanced Muslim civilization was. So these activities fit well, so far as I've seen this semester, they fit well within the context of a traditional history course, a traditional intellectual history course, and I highly recommend them. So, thank you.